Kamla. Welcome to a show where we bring you conversations and interviews with entrepreneurs, technologists, filmmakers, and other newsmakers from in and around the San Francisco Bay Area. My guest today is Jeremy Scahill, who talks about his new documentary, Dirty Wars, The World is a Battlefield. Jeremy has covered wars from various parts of the world, including Afghanistan, Iraq, Yemen, Sudan, and others. In this documentary, Jeremy talks about the USA's covert wars around the world and specifically talks about the Joint Special Operations Command, JSOC, that reports to the president. Previously, Jeremy wrote a book called Blackwater. He currently is the national security correspondent for the magazine The Nation. Here's a clip from the film Dirty Wars, The World is a Battlefield, followed by a conversation that we had with him in San Francisco.
Someone from the inside was reaching out to me. Someone close to the heart of the president's elite force. It's hard to say when the story began. This was supposed to be the front line of the war on terror. But I knew I was missing the story. There was another war. Hidden in the shadows. A night raid.
So there's the two men in the guest house were the first people killed. You saw the U.S. forces take the bullets out of the body.
On your face.
Who were these men that stormed into Dawood's home? And why would they go to such horrifying lengths to cover up their actions?
Airstrikes, targeted killings. A lot of it was a questionable legality.
How had a covert unit taken over the largest war on the planet?
Welcome to the show.
Great to be with you.
Welcome to San Francisco.
Thank you very much.
So we are talking to you from an undisclosed location in San Francisco.
This is my cave, yes.
This is your cave. Beautiful cave.
Yes, I know.
Lap of luxury.
Yeah. Not normally how I roll, but yeah.
A far cry from your Afghan days, from your days in Afghanistan.
Yes, definitely.
Right, yeah. 4 o'clock.
We were sleeping one night, Rick Rowley, the director of the film, and I, we got stuck in a sandstorm in Jalalabad, and we had to sleep at in a little apartment above this convenience store. And we were sleeping on the floor, and I wake up in the middle of the night, and there's something crawling on my leg, and I kick my leg, and it was a gigantic rat.
Oh my goodness.
And it kicked over to Rick, and it did that. So to be speaking to you now in the Ritz-Carlton is a little bit weird. this is not where I'm staying, by the way.
So this is a film. This is your first film.
Yeah, I've never made a film before. Yeah.
So this film is called Dirty Wars. Mm. The World is a Battlefield. Now, for those who have not seen the film, because the film is going to be releasing a bit later in June, how would you describe your film?
You know, this is it's an investigation into an elite, secretive military unit that reports directly to the White House under Republican and Democratic administrations. And historically, this force has been used in a very surgical way around the world. Since 9/11, it's grown to be this incredibly powerful paramilitary arm of the White House, and it's called JSOC, the Joint Special Operations Command. And so, you know, I start off in Afghanistan investigating a night raid where 5 Afghans are killed, including 2 pregnant women, and they're killed by this elite force. And instead of sort of owning that they had raided this house based on bad intelligence, the soldiers who killed these people tried to cover it up and dig the bullets out of their bodies. And so when we learn that the guys that did this operation were not just sort of rank and file American soldiers, but were in fact the most elite soldiers, the president's private army. I became obsessed with JSOC and started to investigate what they were doing around the world. And so when you watch our film, you go on a journey from Afghanistan to Yemen to Somalia and then to the chambers of power in the United States. But it's also, and this was something I didn't really want when we started making the film, but it's a very personal story also. And I share with people what it's like to be a reporter doing this kind of work and how it changes you or affects you.
You've been covering war zones for over 10 years.
Yeah, I started in the late 90s. I spent a lot of time in Iraq and Yugoslavia and Nigeria.
So this is after the first Iraq war.
Yeah, so it was after the 1991. In the US they call it the Gulf War, but yes. That's the second Gulf War, of course. So right, I mean, I was 16 when the U.S. Went to war against Iraq in 1991.
So were you stuck to NBC like every other teenager watching the war unfold?
I remember watching, Bernard Shaw, hearing him under the desk in Baghdad, and Peter Arnett, and thought it was hilarious that there was someone actually named Wolf Blitzer.
So since you've been following war and you've covered war stories for many years, how is it that you didn't know about JSOC? Because JSOC is something that was set up in 1980.
Yeah, 1980.
After the Iranian hostage crisis,
yeah.
Part of which was covered by Ben Affleck's movie.
Yeah, of course. I had never heard of JSOC itself. I, of course, knew that there were special operations forces and that there were Navy SEALs and Delta Force. I mean, that was abundantly clear to anyone who covered these war zones. But I really didn't know about this particular unit, that it was even different from just the Navy SEALs or Delta Force in general, that there was actually a unit that was like an all-star team, and it was very small. They were talking of a couple thousand men in this for much of its existence. And I didn't realize that it was sort of separate from the broader chain of command. So, I mean, I think in retrospect now, because Osama bin Laden is dead and the SEALs did the raid, everyone knows about JSOC and SEAL Team 6. If you were to rewind sort of the clock of your own head back to 2009, this was not a story at all. I mean, we knew that there were special operations forces, but it wasn't like you would hear JSOC.
So you knew there were special operations forces?
Oh, of course.
Forces,
yeah.
But you didn't pursue that strand?
No, because I actually didn't realize. I think part of it, and I admit this in the film because I think it's important to be transparent, I think part of it was that I had a misperception of how the U.S. military was structured. Much of my time as a journalist was spent embedded with civilians, not with the military. And I was trying to tell the other side of the story. I was not a military reporter. I just sort of viewed it as a homogenous entity. I didn't think of it as being the SEALs being any more elite than Army Rangers or Big Army. I mean, I knew that there were special forces, but I didn't understand exactly how they fit into the broader role. And quite frankly, I mean, the fact that these guys are being used to do these what are called targeted killing operations was something that I think was not on a lot of people's radar until well into the Iraq War.
Country was America, you know, and so maybe the notion of war and how wars have to be fought have changed in the last 20, 30 years.
Yeah, I mean, there's very, very few new ideas in war. There's new technology. I think.
And with technology, war fighting undergoes a change. The way wars are fought,
of course,
undergoes a change, and that's what you see in these targeted killings and this kill list that you talk about in various places. Before we go there, how has the JSOC evolved? And talk to us a little bit about the structure. You say it is, president's own private army. Is that the right phrase, for private army? Why do you say it's the president's own private army?
Because they report directly to the president. It's not like they have to go through this commander and that commander and bounce ping pong balls.
So legally, what is the legal framework for them then?
The president's the commander in chief.
Right.
So,
right.
There's military guidelines, but I mean, you know, when I'll give you an example, when Somali pirates took a U.S. flagged vessel in April of 2009, the Maersk Alabama, Obama was directly on the phone with the SEALs that were running that operation. He wasn't going through Tampa and somewhere else to get, he was directly ordering them. The other thing is that this is a force that is meant to be used, including in covert operations. Most Americans, I think that the CIA does covert operations and the military is, doing more overt military operations. JSOC does operations under the same codes of U.S. law that govern covert operations of the CIA, meaning that these units can be used in operations that the U.S. is going to deny later. I mean, if you think about the impact of that, it's quite extraordinary. It's the spy game everyone knows well. CIA guys, in Pakistan, Pakistanis know them. Pakistan has its spies in the United States. It's sort of an accepted part of it. The idea that you use a military force, though, to engage in covert operations is what I think sort of sets JSOC apart from a lot of other forces within the U.S. military. And the reason that I call it the president's private army is that most of the rest of the military has no idea what JSOC is doing at any given time. They are doing things at the direct orders of the White House.
And this is because their end goal is to...
And I don't think that there's necessarily something wrong with, nations have spies, nations have militaries, you have to have forces that can be used for special operations. All of that is, it's not that I'm making a case that shouldn't exist. The issue is, though, that the secrecy of these forces and what they're being used for now, the agendas that they're being used for around the world with this kill program, I think are deeply troubling and disturbing. And this is an organization, you asked me, you know, sort of how it started. I mean, it started after the failed hostage rescue mission in Iran, and for much of the 80s, JSOC sort of operated in Central and Latin America and would be involved with counterproliferation or interdiction, hostage situations. Black Hawk Down happens early on in Clinton's administration. That was a JSOC operation. And what happened is that Clinton basically chained JSOC to a pole in the yard and said, these guys are trouble. And you know, we don't want to use them. That, you know, a big mess happens when you use these guys.
Wasn't there some criticism leveled against President Clinton?
Oh my God, these guys.
Not fully supporting that operation in Somalia.
Of course. I mean, if you talk to guys who were in JSOC at the time, I mean, they blame Bill Clinton for what happened in that operation by not giving them full air support. They wanted AC-130 Spectre gunships. A decision was made in Washington not to give
but
it to
But something
them.
Happened after that failed, after the Black Hawk Down incident, something happened. You know, the world changed in many ways. 9/11 happened,
right.
And then the war on terrorism was declared.
Right, so 9/11 happens, and the CIA and the military, you know, Rumsfeld was in an epic battle, who was the defense secretary at the time, was in an epic battle against the CIA. Cheney, of course, was putting all this pressure on the CIA to give him the intelligence he wanted about Iraq. They were fighting over who was going to be the lead force in the hunt for Osama bin Laden and others. And basically, Cheney and Rumsfeld viewed the CIA as a liberal bunch of wussies and said, you know, they're worthless. The only people that are worth anything at the CIA are the paramilitary guys. And most of those paramilitary guys come from special operations forces. So they said, we're going to use JSOC and we're going to make it the tip of the spear in the hunt for the people that were responsible for 9/11. At the beginning, there were 7 people on the kill list. And as JSOC started to operate around the world, they kept coming up with new names to add to the list. There had never been an Al-Qaeda presence in Iraq. We invade Iraq, and all of a sudden Al-Qaeda comes in. It was like flypaper, catch these guys coming into the country. So now you have new enemies that you have to kill. Then Muqtada al-Sadr and his forces, we declare them to be, you know, terrorist militants. So now we have to go and kill the leadership of his organization. And it just grew and grew and grew. And so JSOC became, you know, this sort of incredible killing machine in Iraq. And by the time Obama becomes president, you know, Admiral William McRaven, who was the commander of JSOC when Obama came into office, Stanley McChrystal, who had been the JSOC commander under the Bush era, these guys basically said to Obama, we need to continue all of these things, and we want expanded authorities. And Obama gave them the green light very, very early on.
So does it boil down to an intelligence gathering factor? And is that one of the reasons they have these kill lists? I'm just trying to understand, and you try to understand yourself in the movie, what are these kill lists? Who generates them?
Right.
You know, how are they generated?
There are 3 kill lists, as far as I understand right now. One is operated by the CIA, one is by JSOC, or the military writ large, and then the third is of super high value targets, and it's operated by the National Security Council, which is the president and his top officials, Secretary of State, Secretary of Defense, National Security Advisor. And we don't know how someone gets on the kill list or off the kill list. Especially in the case of an American citizen, I think it would be very relevant to know what infraction can you commit that puts you on the kill list, which means that you aren't going to be presented evidence against you or an indictment or given a trial. But we don't actually know. And there's a handful of Congress people that are trying to get that answer, but the Bush administration and the Obama administration have really stonewalled on this issue.
So you're looking at missions that are outside of the declared war zone. So
yeah.
Because the war of terror is the larger umbrella.
The AUMF, the authorization for the use of military force, is the legal umbrella that all of this happens under. And the Obama administration continues to use this authorization that was passed after 9/11. Only one Congress member voted against it, Barbara Lee of California. Everyone else voted for it. And basically what it said is, anywhere that there is an individual who had anything to do with Al-Qaeda or the 9/11 attacks, the United States has a right to pursue them. And it basically was a wink and a nod that you can assassinate them. That's how it was interpreted by the Bush and Cheney administration. So, but Obama now uses the AUMF as his justification for conducting operations in Yemen, including against people that were toddlers when 9/11 happened. You know, so it was supposed to just be about people that were attached to the 9/11 attacks. At the end of the day, though, under Article 2 of the U.S. Constitution, the Obama administration and Bush and Cheney made an argument, we are the commander-in-chief, and we can set the foreign policy, and Congress can't say much to us at all about it. And that's even if they repeal the AUMF, they're still going to say Article 2.
If you were to be the president of this country, what would you do?
You'd be in big trouble. if I were to be the president of this country, well, you mean on this issue, what would I do?
Yeah.
Because if you were asking me if I was going to be the president, I would take all of the gold from everyone. No. If I were president, I think that, I'm sure you remember this, but remember when George Ryan issued a moratorium on the death penalty in Illinois? He did it not because he was like an Amnesty International member. He did it because DNA evidence had exonerated a number of prisoners and found out that they were innocent, and then that some innocent people had been put to death. I think with the drone strikes, where we don't even know who we're killing, and these things called signature strikes, where we're targeting people based on being military age males in certain regions of Pakistan or Yemen, we don't know who we're killing. And I think that we need to have a moratorium on the drone strikes and actually figure out who's been killed here.
So as the president, that's what you would do?
Yeah, I would issue a moratorium on the drone strikes, and then I would,
How would you then react if something happened here, if there was a terror attack here and people, come up to you and criticize and say, there was failure of human intelligence, intelligence gathering failed. How would you respond to that?
I mean, it's the same thing that people would say about, why we needed to use torture techniques. I don't believe that we've broken up an imminent plot by drone striking someone. The second part of it is not just that I would put a moratorium on drone strikes and hope everything works out. I think we should use our very robust justice system to pursue criminals. I think we need to demilitarize our response to certain kinds of crimes. I mean, this is ultimately what we're talking about. They're crimes, and people should be brought to justice.
And that's the point you make, that in the movie...
But that's my point.
The Americans, you talk about the Avlaki case and, his son and Samir Khan.
Yeah, but Anwar Avlaki may have been guilty of everything they leaked about him in the press.
But you're saying that there was no...
They didn't present any evidence against him. They didn't indict him. For me, it's not about who he was. It's about who we are. If we don't have a system that's strong enough to handle the most reprehensible of our citizens, then we should stop acting like we're the shining city on the hill and say we're something different. When there are certain people that the response is we're going to get the mob or the posse and the pitchforks and the torches and go and deliver citizens justice, that's not a democratic process. I think that's a big problem.
What do you want people to go away after watching the film?
Yeah, we end the film on a series of questions, and my belief is that we should have had this conversation a long time ago, and I think we want people to go away feeling like they want to discuss these issues with their friends or their family. If I had talked to you 10 years ago, I would probably pretend that I had the answers and what I think we should be doing, but I'm not so arrogant as to believe that. I think if we can get a conversation going, then that will have achieved our mission.
You've left us with more questions than answers.
Yeah, it's not necessarily a bad thing.
Thank you.
Good talking with you. Thank you for having me on the show.
Essentially done is created one hell of a hammer. And for the rest of our generation, this force will be continually searching for an end.
Despite whatever conspiratorial theories, there's nothing to it.
If they are dangerous, if they are too strong, definitely has a missile in his future.
It's important to know when the president can kill an American citizen and when they can.
When you are fighting with enemy, any option is open. No mess.
America knows war. They are war masters.